I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
I'm forgiven.
I'm forgiven. As you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be?
Sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sin.
sit at the table. Come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary. Rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow. Heaven can't cure. So lay down your burden.
Thank you that you're a God that can heal us no matter where we're at. You can find us, Lord God. You're with us wherever we're at in life. Whatever we've done, you have forgiveness, Lord God, and grace and mercy, and we praise you for that. Just pray that you'd open our hearts and our minds now as Pastor Ryan brings a message to us from you and speak to us. Open our hearts. Thank you very much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, family and I were absent last week. We're visiting Sarah's family in the Detroit, Michigan area. So I haven't seen you since Christmas. So did you have a nice Christmas? We got a dog for Christmas. What's it like to have four children and then you add a dog into the mix? Well, in the words of Jim Gaffigan, it's... imagine that you're drowning and someone hands you a puppy. I adjusted that a little bit, but that's kind of the idea. So I know that there's others who have experienced it. They've gone before us and they've had many children and then they bring in, you know, pets. This is new to us. We had some dogs growing up, but they were always outside dogs. This is an inside pee in the house dog. Dog hates me. The dog just absolutely hates me. I know it loves everyone else in the house, but the dog just doesn't like me. What do you do? So anyway, we got a dog. So Happy New Year, 2017. It seems like Y2K was just 17 years ago. You remember that? That was exciting. I remember that night, staying up late that night with Y2K, anticipating what's going to happen, and then nothing happened. It was wonderful. But as I was preparing for this week, I spent some time praying, and I was just like, okay, Lord, I want to have this sense, where is it you're wanting us to go? Where is it you're wanting to take us for 2017? Because obviously we're just coming into this first part of the year. And I felt like the Lord, as I'm praying and I'm looking at, okay, where do you want us to go? I really felt he was taking me to look back. And so he caused me to reflect back. Well, he said, look at, this isn't audible, but this is really what I sense. Look back at 2016. And then I felt like he's causing me to ask myself this question, who are you now and who were you a year ago? And then the question is, are you the same or are you different? And I looked back, so I took the time and I asked myself this question. All right, let's look at this a little bit. And I felt like, okay, I'm different. I'm not the same person that I was a year ago. A number of things have changed. Last year at this time, I was in my 30s. I know, right? Now I am no longer in my 30s. And in doing so, I kind of came to this idea as I looked at myself. I've come to see that I am less capable than I thought I was. And in that same breath, God, I learned, is more capable than I thought he was. You know, so when I look at my life throughout this year, where I'm at now comparative to 1 year ago, 366 days earlier, because it was a leap year, 366 days earlier, that's where it's like God is more capable than I thought he was to handle so much of what I experience in life. And likewise, I am a lot less capable of handling a lot of those things than I realized that I was. And so I want to challenge us as we go through it here today. We're going to be getting into Ephesians chapter 6 here. We're continuing with our Ephesians series that we had taken a break from with the Advent series, which I thought was fabulous. I don't know how you felt about it, but I absolutely loved going through the Advent series. I feel like as I've engaged with that Advent series that we were going with, I felt like God was leading me. He's like, all right, how's your walk? Are you walking with me daily? Are you walking with me moment by moment? And it was really challenging me in my constant walk. Where are you, Ryan? What are you doing? What's going on? How can, you know, listen to me. I'm leading you as we go. And so I thought that was fabulous. I enjoyed the Advent series. So I'm going to say that was wonderful, whether you agreed with me or not. It was good. It was good for me. But I want to challenge us as we engage with this morning, as we engage with 2017, to ask ourselves the question, as we look back at 2016, Mike, if you get a chance, my voice is in rough shape today. Would you get me a glass of water? Thank you. I want to challenge us to, what did you do in 2016? You know, so take some time. It doesn't have to be now. Please don't let it be now, in fact. But throughout this next week, what did you do? And then look alongside of that. What did God do? How can you identify some things that God had done in your life and is working in your life? Are you any different now than you were a year ago at this time? Is your walk with the Lord closer than it was a year ago at this time? And so as I looked back and the Lord revealed those things to me, then I felt like I was able to look forward to 2017. And as we look at this passage of scripture in Ephesians, it became really passionately clear to me that this is all about the gospel. You know, and we've talked about that already with the book of Ephesians. It's all about Christ. It's all about the gospel. And so I felt like as we engaged 2017, I have a pretty good idea as to where I want us to go, where I feel like the Lord wants us to go. And I want this to be a year in which it's a year of the gospel. You know, we look at this gospel of truth, and everything, and we're going to see this throughout this year, everything that we do, everything that we are about is going to be permeated with, all right, it's the gospel. We're going to carry it with us. Where we go, what we speak, it's going to just be, it's about the gospel. It's about what Christ has done. And so this year of 2017, I want it to be a year of the gospel. Thank you, Mike. Now I can say some things every few words. I should like turn the mic off when I take these sips because it's really loud and learn to drink quietly. So I want this year to be a year that is about the gospel. I want it to be where this church comes together as the body of Christ and saying, you know, as an individual, as this corporate body of Christ, we are about the gospel. And we are about the gospel going forward. And so we are going to bring this gospel forth with our words, with our actions, with our deeds, with our prayer life. And all aspects of our lives are going to be permeated with this idea of carrying the gospel forward. And we're going to see that this morning in some wonderful ways, especially if you're a parent. Because this has been one of my favorite verses in the Bible since I was the age of 28. Because at the age of 28, I had a child. And this verse in the Bible says this. It says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Suddenly, I have a favorite verse, you know? You know, you ask, well, what's your favorite verse? Well, this is now my favorite verse. Interestingly, when I was growing up, I didn't care for this verse. I know it sounds obvious, but here's the honest truth. Growing up in church, like even in Sunday school, I felt like this was constantly being driven down my throat, this idea, you know, from Sunday school teachers, and it's like, I'm thinking, enough already. I was I don't know that I would have articulated this then, but it sure felt like this is something that parents came up with just to keep their children doing what they want them to do. And there was times, I said this to my dad one time, I said, I can't wait to have kids of my own because then I can have them do everything that I don't want to do. You know, I was so convinced that my parents were having me do everything that they didn't want to do. I was like their personal little slave, you know. And now I'm a parent, like, I was clueless, you know, totally clueless. And now my children think the same thing. But there's this, what we're going to find here this morning is we see this passage in Ephesians chapter 6. We're going to go through verses 1 through 9. And what we're going to see is we have children obey your parents in the Lord. And then we're going to see it transition. We're going to see the word slave in here. And we're going to wrestle with that briefly. But we're also going to see how these interactions, you know, children and slaves are kind of one and the same, right? That was a joke. But what we're going to see is this idea, everything that we do is designed to carry the gospel forth. And we're going to see it in children today. We're going to see it in parents. We're going to see it, we'll talk about it and how we deal with it with slaves and how we deal with it with masters. And so here it is, my favorite verse. I love this part of the verse. Your children, obey your parents in the Lord. And then it says, for this is right. There is something that is good about this short sentence, a short passage of scripture. And he says, children, listen to me, obey your parents. Not just because I said so, but because there is something intrinsically good about this. When you obey your parents, something happens. There is something powerful in the fact that children obey your parents. I know I see children squirming already and parents are smiling and thinking, this is the greatest thing ever. I want to listen to this guy preach way more often. And it's going to get harder, especially if you're a teenager. Buckle up. Okay. But there is something that is powerful when we choose to obey our parents. There's something happens. There's a message that is sent. And it's a gospel message, because it points back to Christ and to who he is. And so this continues, and in verse 2 it says, honor your father and mother. This is one of the Ten Commandments that we read about in Exodus and then repeated in Deuteronomy. And what's fascinating, and then he says, which is the first commandment with a promise. So you have all these commandments. You talk about the Ten Commandments. Well, this one has something attached to it, and we'll talk about it in just a second. So there's something different, slightly different about this commandment in particular, where it says, honor your father and mother. So we just read in verse 1, children, obey your parents, which is a very honoring thing to do. But then he flips it back. This is Paul's writing, flipped it back to them and says, remember the Ten Commandments, honor your father and mother. Yesterday was my dad's birthday. I'd like to tell you how old he is, but I forget myself. I want to say it's 62. But on his birthday, I don't know, this might just be intentional, might just be totally ironic, you know, timing, but my mom sent me a picture. I don't know why she sent me this, but she apparently came across this picture. She's probably going to be so upset that I showed this all to you, but I thought, you know, a couple things. One, she sent it to me, so it's fair game. And number two, this picture was a church picture. You know how we have this picture board up here that's way outdated? Bingo. This picture was there probably until I was like in my mid-20s, okay? But this is my family here, where I was growing up. Our scissors hadn't been invented yet. It's obvious. Obviously. In fact, yesterday, Isaac looks at this picture and he says to me, so was that like normal for everyone to have long hair then? Maybe, or it might have just been our family just not cutting our hair. But yeah, you can see some of the, this is my older brother, you know, some of that mullet. He kept that mullet until his 30s, I think. And this is, my dad looks pretty much the same, only all of his hair, you have to envision it now, it's just white. Okay. My mom hasn't changed a bit except for, you know, shorter hair in that sense. My mom would have been probably about 30 years old then, and 4 children, and they had probably 2 dogs, you know, so she was really drowning. But I thought it was fun to show you that. So in honoring my father, I showed you the picture. In honoring my father yesterday, so it was his birthday, I got him the same thing I got him last year, which is nothing. I sent him a text in the morning, said, happy birthday. That's good enough, right? Well, I felt guilty about it. I was like, you know, that's not really honoring to my father. And so I actually called him then last night, woke him up out of bed. That's not true. Made that part up. But anyway, I called him last night. And I thought, you know, he deserved to be honored. Because I've just wrestled through this passage, you know, so how can I go through this and just saying disregard, you know. So I called him up, and we had a nice talk. And it was honoring, and that was the intentionality behind it. But there is something powerful about a child honoring and obeying their parents. You know, not only for that relationship with the parent and the child, but also for those who see it happening.
There is a message that is sent, and it is a gospel message that says Jesus Christ is Lord. And watch this. So here we got back to this promise here now. So in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 3, this is the commandment with a promise. This is the promise. So that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. In the original commandment found in Exodus 20 and Deuteronomy 5, it's virtually identical. There's one change that Paul makes on the passage. And in the original, it talked about the promised land. You know, that it will go well with you when you enter the promised land was the idea. So that was the promise to them. But Paul makes and remember in Ephesians, we've looked at this, and it was for not only the Jews, but also the Gentiles. We saw that in Ephesians chapter 1, how he adopted us, even the Gentiles, how he adopted us as part of his family. So now this promised land, in a sense that God is laying out and that Paul is describing to us, is the earth, so that it will go well with you where I have placed you. And that's the promise. So when we, as children, we obey and honor our parents, which is right, which is good, which sends a message, we also see that it will go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. You know, and going along with that, Psalm 24 says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. So this promised land that the Israelites had was a small piece, but this is the broad sense. And so that as we have been placed here on earth, wherever we have been placed, that it will go well with you. So when children obey their parents, it is an expression of the gospel. When children obey their parents, it points back to Christ. And just recently, as we covered Ephesians chapter 5 a few weeks ago, see what it says here. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children. So this is one chapter before we see the same word children. And the association is different now, though, because he's talking about us as being God's children. You know, in chapter 6, we're seeing children obeying their parents. And here what we have is we are identified as God's children, as Christ's children. And then we see it again in Ephesians 5, verse 8. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. We are his children. And so then what we have is we have this parallel role. We talked about it a few weeks ago when we dealt with Ephesians chapter 5 and we had wives and husbands and how wives are supposed to submit to their husbands and how husbands are supposed to love their wives. And why are they supposed to do it? Because Christ submitted himself to them and we are supposed to submit ourselves to one another. But he did it because he died on the cross for us. And so we are supposed to do likewise. And so the idea of it is, when wives submit to their husbands, it points back to what Christ did to us. He submitted to us, and he shouldn't have had to do that, and yet he did it. And so it points back to him. When husbands love their wives, it points back to Christ because Christ loved us. When children obey their parents, it points to Christ because we, as children of God, obey him. You see where all of this is like encompassing all these aspects of our life. I mean, it's dealing with parenting and being a child, and all of that we do is pointing back to Christ. It has that intentionality to point back to him. And then it doesn't end there. It switches on us, which I was all happy and go lucky here until we get to the parenting aspect of it, because I, as a parent, have been known to frustrate my children from time to time. According to this passage of Scripture, it's not supposed to happen, but I don't know. I'm going to question the Scripture then maybe a little bit. But it says, fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and in the instruction of the Lord. And so what we have, the word exasperate, trying to think what other words were used. The idea of it is you are not to provoke your children to anger is the idea. You know, and it's this idea of you are to treat, as a parent, you are to treat your children well and justly. That doesn't mean give them everything that they want. That's not it at all, and we're going to get into that this morning. But when we see this balance between parenting and being a child and children obeying, you know, the passage that we just covered does not state, children, argue with your parents if you think that they are wrong. You know, it says obey them. It says submit to them. It doesn't say, children, reason with your parents if you don't get your way. You know, have a discussion with them. See if you can convince them and manipulate them otherwise. Wait a minute, I didn't read that in there. That's different. That's not fitting. It doesn't say, children, throw a fit when they ask you to do something. It happens, doesn't it?
Yep.
That's right. I know it. Yeah, these are not personal examples, but yes, every one of them fits. Do not manipulate them with your moods, your attitudes. But here's the thing. Our culture has developed into a culture where teenagers are expected to rebel against their parents. You know what I'm saying? It's expected. So as your kids go into middle school, high school, maybe even late elementary, there's almost this expectation where children are supposed to rebel against their parents. Well, my mom says I shouldn't do that. Ugh, forget your mom. Just go do whatever you want. There's this expectation that that's what should happen. And that's not what's going to point back to Christ. Teenagers, when a teenager disobeys, dishonors, or rebels against their parents, in reality, are you listening to this, teenagers? You're going to hate this, but I'm going to say it anyway. They are disobeying, dishonoring, and rebelling against God. That's what it boils down to. So, teenager, if you are a teenager and you are a follower of Christ, then the actions that you take should be influenced with this reality that what you do points back to Christ. In other words, if God values obeying your parents because it honors Him, then you ought to value obeying and honoring your parents because it honors Him. Do you track that? Do you follow that? So you may not be agreeing with what your parents are saying, but if you are truly a follower of Christ and you're saying, I want to do what God has said that I am to do, whether your parent you agree with your parents or not, the reality of it is, if I'm going to honor God, I need to also then honor my parents. And I got to be honest, I think most teenagers look at that and would rather discredit it, rightly so. I mean, if we honestly were thinking back to when we were teenagers as well, which for me was just like a year ago, I was a teenager just like that. We think back, my parents didn't know anything. You know what I mean? That was our attitude. And then suddenly there comes this idea like, wow, maybe I was the one. And so in honoring our parents, in honoring God, it's important for us to understand that honoring our parents is vital. So as parents then, we look at this idea of not provoking our children, how you treat your children. Certainly you can love your children, and sometimes, you know, like I said with the joke at the beginning from Jim Gaffigan, imagine you're drowning and someone hands you, you know, a puppy or a baby or whatever the case is. It's like, wow, that just got totally intense. I don't know what to have, you know, what to do next, what to have happen. And that's a reality in our lives because parenting, if you've been a parent, it's a challenge. You know, because you're dealing with these kids, you have multiple kids too, it's just like, you sometimes don't know which way is up, you don't know how to even catch your breath, you don't know how to find a break, whatever the case may end up being, and that's extremely challenging, and it's exhausting, and when we get exhausted, we find ourselves reacting in ways that we would rather not react in. You know, that's a fair assumption. And so when we look at this idea in this verse, okay, do not exasperate, do not provoke your children to anger. Sometimes maybe as parents, we need to, you know, separate ourselves a little bit. Okay, I need to approach this well so that I'm, you know, I'm treating my child well, I'm training my child well. And that's the idea. It's this idea of training and discipline, which we'll touch on in a little bit. So fathers, and I find a little offense that it just says fathers. Apparently mothers don't provoke their children like fathers do. That's just something I noticed. You know, because it started off and it said, children, obey your parents, both. And then Paul switched it, and fathers, stop being so provoking. Anyway. But bring them up in the training and the instruction of the Lord. That's huge. You look at this word training and instructing. You know, there's discipline that's involved here. We are to discipline our children. You know, and there's a parallel. When we discipline our children, I hate this, but when we discipline our children, it points back to Christ. It's part of the gospel because when we live a life where we're following Christ, you can expect to be disciplined. Christ disciplines those he loves. He disciplines those and he rebukes those that he cares for. And then we find this shift, and I want to cover this, and we'll come back to what we were talking about in a moment, dealing with the disciple disciplining. So then Paul switches, and he talks about slaves, and we look at this, we can get hung up a little bit about this on slaves. Excuse me. This is the best water you've brought to me all day, Mike. Yeah. So he switches on to slaves. And the idea here with slaves, we can get hung up on the word slaves, and there's different schools of thought. You know, some say, well, it was just a servant, you know, because we don't like the term slave, all right? And I get that. I understand that. That makes sense. Why would we like it? Because we have a lot of negative connotations with it. And in this culture, it may not have been that different. But I want us to grasp a couple things. One is this was a part of their culture. Like the idea of divorce, how God allowed divorce in the Old Testament and the New Testament for that matter because their hearts were hardened. I think God is recognizing this fact that, all right, slavery, it's happening. It's part of their culture. And he doesn't necessarily say slavery is good, but what he's saying, all right, fine, your hearts are hard and this is what you're going to do. Well, then this is the way you ought to treat them. So I want us to kind of grasp that a little bit, but there is some capacity where these slaves were paid. We don't know necessarily how much. I'm guessing it wasn't a lot. It was very much probably considered slave labor, but we have this instruction towards slave and to masters. And for us, we can't maybe relate to that, but I want us to consider it in this capacity of what about our employment, all right? Because sometimes as an employee, maybe you feel like a slave, right? Okay, especially if you're a teenager working at some company or whatever the case is, you're the low person on the totem pole. Notice I said person, you know, that's, you know, politically correct instead of lotus man. So let's say you're low on the totem pole and everything else, everyone's just stepping on you. That's, you have to do this, whatever. And you just feel like I'm nothing but a slave. Well, we have some instructions here from Paul that kind of says how we are to react, because how we react in those situations points to Christ. And likewise, then we're going to see instructions for masters, because as a boss, as a manager, as a supervisor, likewise, we have a role that as we engage those who are our subordinates, it points back to Christ. This whole book of Ephesians, which is not a gospel as we call it, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, but it's filled with this gospel message. And it says, slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. There it is. That's the message that he's been sending this whole time. Obey just as you would Christ, because when you obey them, you're pointing back to Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. This is interesting. I got to hit this. Paul, in his writing, throughout the New Testament and all of his epistles, he uses this phrase, slaves to sin. And he associates, he says, when you choose to follow Christ, you are no longer slaves to sin. You know, so in other words, you see this picture. You have a slave, and you can't be a slave unless you have a master. And so envision this person, me, and I am a slave to sin. So sin is my master. And he says, you are no longer a slave to sin. In other words, you don't work for sin any longer when you choose to follow Christ. Right? That relationship has been severed, so now you have the freedom to not have to obey that master anymore. I mean, are you tracking with that? And that's huge to understand that. Because sometimes what we do is we choose to follow Christ, and that relationship has been severed, and we don't know any other way to live, and so we continue then to follow this master because that's who I've always followed. We follow the master of sin. And what Paul says is, you've been set free. You are a free person. You don't have to be in that bondage of sin any longer. And so when we kind of pair that up here, what we have, when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, in other words, our transition has been, now I no longer have to obey sin. Sin no longer is my authority. It can tell me whatever it wants me to do. I don't have to do it. But then Christ says, you are a slave to Christ. And so now I have a new master, a good master. A master that's going to point or care for me in such ways that we're going to see described here, that's revolutionary. I mean, it changes your life to realize I don't have to do what sin is calling me to do any longer. Here it is, verse 7. Serve wholeheartedly, this is for the slave, as if you were serving the Lord and not people. As you're an employee, wherever your occupation is, this is applicable. Serve the people that you work for wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not people. because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free. And then masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours, that's Christ, is in heaven. In other words, so as you are dealing with your employees, keep this in mind. You have a master over you as well. And so I want you to treat them, in a sense, as how I treat you. Because when you treat them how I treat you, that's pointing back to Christ. That's living out the gospel. That's carrying the gospel wherever you go. And there is no favoritism with him. This is remarkable. So we talk about this idea of parents, and we talk about this idea of children, and even with the slave and the masters, there's a word that comes to mind, and it's the word discipline. Discipline is difficult. We don't like it. And especially here we are, it's the new year. Many of us perhaps have made a New Year's resolution, and that maybe lasted till January 3rd, maybe. Maybe some of us are still going, but it takes discipline to make changes in our life. And this is what we find in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. I don't have it up on the screen, but I'm going to read it a little bit, verse by verse. And we're going to wrap it up here with this, because this passage points to the idea of discipline. What we have is we have children who need discipline. Isn't that right, children? That's right. We have parents who need discipline. And they have an interesting role, because not only do they need discipline, they also have to administer discipline. And then we see it with employees. I'm using the word employees instead of slaves. They need discipline. And likewise with masters, they need discipline as well as they have to administer discipline. So this is what it says in Hebrews chapter 12. I'm going to start at verse 1. We're going to read 11 verses. It says, therefore, again, this is Paul's writing, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. The image I got with this is, imagine, I coached track and field for a number of years, and the idea with track and field, people get serious about it to the extent of they will like get the lightest shoes that they can find. You know, or if you're a bicycle enthusiast, you oftentimes will try to get as little weight on your bicycle as possible, especially if you're in a race. You know, you don't ever see anyone on the track putting on a backpack of rocks and then saying, all right, let's do this. You know, watch me run now. And rather, we throw off everything that entangles. And there's sin in our life that slows us down. There's sin in our life that keeps us from following Christ the way he is calling us to follow him. And he's saying, throw it off. It's no longer your master. Get rid of it. Verse 2. And he says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. To keep your eyes fixed on. Here's the thing, our culture, we like to write and be the ones in control. We like to write our own destiny, if you will. But here's what it says is, he is the author and the perfecter of our faith. He wrote it. He gets to kind of choose as to where he wants it to go. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Here it is. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding of blood. And you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. The word punish there is actually can be used. I'm a little surprised that the NIV uses that word, because in most cases it would be the word like chastens, you know. And it's a little bit different than punishing, because when you look at the Greek and the Hebrew words, when you find the word punishment, usually it has to do with God causing punishment on the nations that are against him. You know, these are like a permanent idea of punishment where I will cut them off, they are gone. There's his wrath and his punishment go hand in hand. Well, the word that we have here is actually quite different. What we have here is this idea of it's administered by love. I discipline you because I love you. And so we have this contrast between discipline and punishment. And sometimes we have trouble disassociating those things. And so when I think of God's discipline on me, all I'm really thinking is his punishment. And so rather than thinking, I don't want God's discipline, we ought to be thinking, Lord, I need your discipline. Because it's through your discipline that's going to change who I am from today to what I will be like a year from now in 2018. And so children, you should love the discipline from your parents. Just get excited, get so excited when your parents say, it's time for the discipline. Because, I know it sounds so funny, and all the kids are going, I hate this. Because when you're disciplined, it's making you more into God, who God has created you and desires for you to be. And parents, as you administer that discipline, keep in mind that that's your goal, is to help create these children into who God has desired and created them to be. And parents, adults, understand this. I don't care how old you are, God has not done disciplining you. Sometimes we shut it off thinking, at my age, no discipline's left for me. I tell this one story. I'll probably get in trouble. I'll probably get arrested after the service. Tell this one story. Hannah was our oldest, or she is our oldest, you know, firstborn. And so, unfortunately for the firstborn, they receive all of our mistakes, you know, all of the things that we do that we thought was a good idea at the time. And so we did not, let's just say this, we did not spare the rod, okay? You know what I mean by that? Okay. And so we had this rod that happened to be this wooden spoon. You know, this is great. It's wonderful. Everyone loves parents. This is one of my favorite stories ever. So she got to be associating this rod, this wooden spoon, with the consequence, with the punishment. And so sometimes she would refer to this wooden spoon as the spanking spoon. Well, that made us uncomfortable because we didn't want the wrong people coming into the house saying, oh, you have a spanking spoon. Here it is. We'll arrest you now. So anyway, we tried to start convincing her. I didn't know this. Sarah tried to start convincing her. No, that's the spoon for making macaroni and cheese. It's the same spoon. I know. And so I was upset. I don't remember the consequence. She wasn't staying in bed or something like this. I go into her room. You know, you always make a big to-do out of the rattling of the drawer, you know, because that's what's going to do it. It's really not the spoon. But you rattle the drawer so they can hear it coming. So you rattle the drawer. You open the drawer and you pull out the spoon and then you go marching into the room. And I said, do you know what this is for? And she didn't say anything. I said, do you know what this is for? And she didn't say anything, and I say, you get in bed, or you're going to, I don't remember what my threat was. So I turned to walk away, and as I'm turning to walk away, she's in her tears, just saying, it's for making roni and cheese. yeah. Anyway. True story. But the idea of it is, I'm trying to teach her to obey me. Because her life will go well when she obeys me. And likewise, the Lord is bringing discipline. Sometimes life might be really tough. And I'm not saying every hardship that you face is discipline, but I think some of it is. And we may not be comfortable with it. I think even things that the enemy attacks us with can leave us feeling like I'm being punished, and maybe that's not God that brought it, like Job, you think of Job? I think God brought great discipline into Job's life through the enemy's attacks on him. So even if the enemy is attacking, it's all his work, I think the Lord can teach us things and bring great discipline, and we may find ourselves a vastly different person in 2018 than we are right now. Someone who's ready to carry the gospel forward. You know, who's passionate about all this work that the Holy Spirit is doing. So I'm going to invite the elders up. We're going to transition into a time of communion. And here at Alliance Church, we practice what we call open communion. That means if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are welcome to participate. We don't close the door to anyone. You don't have to be a member of this church to participate in communion. You do have to be a believer. The scriptures are clear about that. Those who have professed the faith in Christ, they are called to celebrate this with and in remembrance of him. But as we take this morning and we take time to remember Christ, remember his suffering, remember his body being broken, and remember his blood being shed, I want us to think through. It's not, I mean, that part is done. But his work in us is not done. He is still working in you. So as we partake, and we'll pass the bread, and I just ask that you hold it until everyone has been served, and then we'll eat the bread together. And then we'll do the same thing with the cup. And as you hold the cup, hold it and be contemplating. It's like, all right, he shed his blood for me. My life ought to point back to him and what it is that he did for us. So on the night, the scriptures say, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he did two things. He started first off, and he took this bread with his friends, his disciples. And as he was taking this bread, he broke it in front of his 12 closest friends. And he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. And he says, this do in remembrance of me every time that you eat it. So as these elders serve and as Pam plays, just reflect. Reflect on what he has done for you and what your life looked like now compared to a year ago and where God's leading you for this year. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for that work where you allowed your body to be abused and broken. And you did it for us. So Lord, I thank you. And I thank you for your discipline. How you train us to become more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's eat. After he had taken the bread, he then took the cup. And he told his closest friends, his disciples, that this blood, this cup, was a symbol of the blood that he would shed for the remissions of sins. And then he would say again, do this and remember this every time that you drink it. So hold the cup until we have a chance to drink it together. Jesus Christ went willingly and spilled his blood so that we could have forgiveness, so we could have that slavery, that bondage that we had had to sin could be separated. We could have a new master. And sometimes that comes with discipline. And so my prayer for us today as we remember what Christ did, that we can understand our role. Maybe submit to authorities in our life, our role as an authority, and the way that we treat those who may be under our authority. the way that as parents we discipline our children and why we do it, and as children, the way we ought to honor and obey our parents, because all of it, every aspect of our life is intended to point back to Christ. So we can think of those things and remember him and what he did for us as we drink together. Let's drink. We're going to conclude this morning. I'm going to invite Kevin and the worship team back up. And we're going to conclude. And I just, as they're coming up, at the end of the song, we're going to be free to go. We're going to be dismissed, if you will. But allow the song, this is what I believe. If this is really what we believe, then it really ought to affect our lives. And I want to announce this here then, too, at this time, two things. One is when we celebrate communion, we like to take a secondary offering. And this goes to something very specific. It goes to a benevolent fund in which we give to people in this church body, in this community, as they have need. So there will be ushers at the doors that will be receiving an offering for that specifically. The other thing is these connect groups that are starting up again for this semester. If you're not involved in a connect group, I want to encourage you to get involved in a connect group. And in your connect group this morning, it's designed to get to know one another. Excuse me. Thank you so much, Mike. And in your connect group, it's designed this morning to just really kind of start to get to know who's in your group. So it's very non-threatening. It's very free. And in doing so, maybe you want to take some time and reflect who you were a year ago to who you are now. You know, maybe that's a question that you want to bring up and talk in your connect groups. But Kevin, lead us in worship.
Judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God. The Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you. Resurrection when Jesus
Dismissed. Thank you very much.